Hey everybody, welcome to a new episode of the Hart and Usagi Podcast. I am Hart Knight, aka Matt, and this is the episode 31. We're gonna focus mainly on BioShock Infinite this episode. No Usagi this time; he hasn't played the game, and therefore is not needed. So I threw him out with the trash, just like with my terrible and podcast postponing awful mic. So got that replaced. We're back in business. Not like any of you would notice anyway. But with me this time, two other bros. We got SonicHomeboy, Eddie. How you doing?
Yo, I'm doing fine.
All
Doing
right.
fine.
And second time on the show, light narcissus, I think is what you go for now.
Yes.
Say your first name.
Unch.
Ansh, there we go.
Unch.
Get the pronunciation right. Ansh. Okay. All
Unch.
right.
Okay, that's cool. Stop, everyone.
Perfect. We're done. Okay. So, we all played BioShock Infinite. I took an ass load of time, but I got through it. I guess to kick it off, I can say that the opening part before I even got a gun was took me about 55 minutes. I even mentioned this in the blog post about a couple weeks ago. And one thing, the main reason I took so damn long to get through that part was just because I was looking for everything that I could find.
You're not the only one. Yeah, it's what it's. I mean, some people may find the beginning very slow. I kind of took it to like absorb my surroundings, try to familiarize myself with the setting of the floating city of Columbia, and I have to say, like a lot of it was just breathtaking. Like, I mean, just the overall atmosphere. It just. I don't know, I just want to say it was very surreal. Like it was like the way that they had the city all planned out is like, okay, I can actually see myself like in this type of environment. Like it was very believable, to say the least.
I'm not sure who were the people who were disappointed by the 55-minute long intro, because if you're playing a BioShock game, then the setting is going to be one of the key features about it. And you always have to expect that the game is going to take its swell time to get familiarized with the setting, as well as you have to learn how to explore the tiny details. And that is basically what Columbia is all about. It has all these details in every corner of it, and exploring is one of the key aspects of the game. So I think the first 55 minutes did a good job in creating a kind of feel about the game, that this game may be a first-person shooter, but its main focus is far from that. Its main focus is on the place, Colombia, or at least that's what it seems initially. And it's more about adventure. So basically, even if I'm skipping a couple of more topics into this, it's one of the main criticisms about BioShock Infinite was that it would have been better if it was not a shooter. And I can partly agree with that, because I think many aspects of it would be much more refined, or were much more suited to first-person adventure. So if it was basically a completely narrative-driven experience, minus the shooting parts, then it would have been a lot more cohesive experience. Because at times, BioShock Infinite seems like it's just slipping in all those shooting parts just for the sake of it being a shooter.
Well said, sir. Well said. And I like how my 55 minutes, notion of 55 minutes apparently is now the official amount of time. But anyways, yeah, when I started in, I noticed, all the people, basically you replace God with the Comstock and stuff like that. and
yeah, Comstock and the so, like the founding fathers of the nation.
Yeah, and it was just to me the otherwise, you know, you swap one for the other. Otherwise, it was exactly the same the way people were acting. Mm-hmm. You know, acting like there's just a, thank him for this and that and everything else. And I remember one spot. You get to a point where it's kind of this fountain in the middle of this one central area.
Yeah.
Mm, and there's this yeah. This woman with her child on the picnic setup.
Yeah.
And just what she was saying, how you're going to grow up, you're going to make yourself and yourself. I'm like, not in this setting or not. Not with this brainwashing or not. And I was just, you know, really into the whole aspect of them really hitting hard with the, you know, racism. It was clearly a thing yeah. that the society was all about. Keep it pure. And I was just like, even had posters about that crap and stuff. Mm-hmm. And when I got to the point where I finally started the combat, you know, right before you do that, you go, and just to point out, because, you know, I love this word so much, and that's why I don't want to use it, but I'm going to. We are going to say whatever. If people don't want to hear this, obviously they don't have to listen to this podcast. So I'm going to spoil this shit, so.
Yeah, there will be spoilers. You cannot talk about this game without spoilers.
Yeah, otherwise, I don't think you can with any game, because it's like most games is like, if you don't talk about things that would otherwise reveal things, you pretty much are you can just, it can be switched out with any game, and you don't really know what you're talking
about. Yeah, that's true, but it's particularly more true for BioShock Infinite, because it is a game which people will talk about because of its twists and because of how the story eventually pans out to be.
Yeah, right. I'm. It sounds like honestly that you remember more of the story than maybe I kind of do. At least some of the details, because there's some twists. I'm just like, is this, and it goes this way, and it goes that way, and it kind of whiplashes you sometimes. But it's all good anyway, so I don't mind it. But
yeah.
But I even mentioned this in my blog post a couple of weeks ago, is that when you get to that point where that guy asks you, you know, hey, you got to throw the ball, and you get that choice of throwing it at him or throwing it at the people that...
Yeah, that's right.
I'm pretty much at that point, if you're taking this seriously and not rushing through it, you're going to answer how you would answer in real life. And right. I feel like if you're a fucking racist in real life, you're going to throw it at the couple. So
yeah, or...
just like, take this to the balls, you announcer bastard.
Exactly.
That's yeah. where my balls went, to his balls.
But unfortunately, they had to stop you in mid-throw, so...
Yeah. Yeah, actually, I don't know if you want to discuss this right now, but one of the interesting facts about this is that no matter what you choose, the outcome is always going to be the same.
Really?
So, yeah. Oh. So the second way around, the second time around, if you... try throwing it, they also catch you before you throw it. So it's pretty much the same scenario everywhere. And I guess I'll talk about this later on, because once we actually talk about how the story actually ends and things
course,
like that.
Yeah.
So then what I talk about will become more relevant. So yeah, edit this thing out.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just, I mean, I figured that wasn't going to mean much to the story to make that choice, but it for the first time, the few choices you get in the game, that's pretty pretty big one, despite yeah. that, may not make a whole lot of difference in the long run, but overall it's not going to, because then we're going to get into Mass Effect and that whole debacle, we don't need to go there, so.
No, I
think that's a good example of giving too much choice.
Yeah, I mean, I will say too this. Much... Like, no, go ahead.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Well, I was gonna say, like, going back to the throwing the baseball. Like, I recently started my second playthrough, mm-hmm. and I really wanted to give that the throwing the ball at the couple a shot, but I was like, it kind of hits you in some ways, like, no, because if I do, then I'm just going to feel guilty. So I just, I still threw it at was, I think it was Fink, I think, that is the announcer there. So, yeah, I just, like, regardless, I just threw it at him instead of the couple. Because, I mean, it left such an impact. It's like, okay, I know it's just a game, but...
Well, first time through in any game, I usually do what I would do otherwise. Yeah. But later on, I can do whatever because it's just a game. So I'm not really, sure. I'm not hung up by that. I don't have that problem if that's such a problem.
Yeah, I do the same thing as Matt. Like, even when I'm playing Mass Effect, the first time when I'm playing through it, I play and make decisions like I would in actual life and what mm-hmm. I believe in. And second time, I just play around, screw it, and just play it for fun. So
that
was basically it. But for BioShock, it was basically the decisions are always split between one or two, this or the other. So if I, for second playthrough, for me, the choice was pretty simple. Like, I'm going to choose what I didn't choose the first time around. So, yeah, it didn't affect the story much. But the thing is that if it was any other game, then people would have called it linear, or they would have been like, we make decisions and there's no replay value because those decisions don't alter the story in a very significant way. But it doesn't, that criticism cannot be seen valid for Infinite because there's a specific theme which kind of validates that decisions not mattering in the long run. And that is where we'll eventually come to.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The illusion. People like the illusion of choice. But I gotta mention real quick, it's kind of getting a little bit off topic, and that is that I felt that when the original BioShock initially came out, and of course it was only Xbox at the time, mm-hmm. I feel like it got more praise than it otherwise would have if it wasn't for the fact that that was a pretty, that summer was a fairly drought, big name, big game droughts, you know, of a summer. And so people were really chomping at the bit to get something that they've been anticipating. And I think around August that year, that was when that one came out. And so everyone was all like, more or less praising it because they're more or less saying, finally a game that I want to play that's out. That damn summer had nothing. Did you feel that way at the time? That it
I can agree with you that BioShock did receive much more praise than it actually deserved. But I don't think it was because of its release time slot. It was, I think, more to do with the kind of themes which it represented. Because for a game to represent themes of objectivism or Ayn Rand, it's pretty much unusual, or it was considered unusual back then. Especially for a shooter. And I think BioShock was very strong in a aesthetic manner. Like, the atmosphere was really good. And the critique which it made on the philosophy of objectivism was something which critics completely were taken in surprise that a game could do this. Then that's why they showered it with such high scores. Because otherwise it was nothing special, because it was pretty much a mediocre corridor shooter, and it didn't have anything going for it besides that.
Yeah, that sounds about right. Though you got to admit that was pretty good timing on the release date. True. That's pretty much the first one of the fall season, and that's usually when they all come out. So that also, yeah. I think that maybe I'm thinking it had more to do with it than it really did, but I'm sure it had something to do with
it.
So, well, anyways, back to Infinite, because it's infinitely infinite, whatever that means, you'll figure it out. let's see, I'm trying to think of I guess they don't have to necessarily go in order from the game, just much as like what a
Talk about
something that stuck out to you. Eddie, you go ahead.
What stuck out to me the most? I actually enjoyed using the when possible, using the sky hook, whether it was like doing finishing moves on the enemies, or like riding the skyline, or actually kind of assassinating people from above.
Especially the assassinations.
Yeah.
And they drilling it into their necks.
Yes.
Oh, yes. So satisfying.
Especially
when you did it to the racist at the beginning. Take that.
Yeah. So, the having the skyhook was really, really neat because it just shows that you weren't limited to your guns or the vigor powers that you had. You could actually use the skyhook for other means of transportation and for like melee combat. So it was a nice change of pace as far as gameplay mechanics go.
Yeah, I agree on that, because if you compare the original BioShock with Infinite, then the major difference in terms of level design is attributed because of the skylines, because skylines increase the verticality of the levels, because the first BioShock took place entirely underwater, and that's why it was basically one corridor to one area.
Yeah.
And even the larger areas were basically linear in a sense. And when you increase the verticality of the entire level, it just gives an entirely new breadth of playing. So I think that was one of the major reasons why I really enjoyed BioShock Infinite shooting, because other than that, it was fairly similar to what BioShock was, because the plasmids became the vigors and the shooting basically was pretty similar in a general sense. Although I think what I liked about it is, like, we're talking about shooting, so I'll say what I liked about the shooting. I think I liked how you could shoot people from far off. Like, even with general weapons, you could do a simple headshot from far off. Now, I do not see a lot of shooters doing that in today's day and age, because most of them are aiming for realism, so that thing is obviously, such kind of behavior is not possible in real life. But Infinite doing it makes it much more enjoyable, because it has all these huge battlegrounds where enemies are constantly coming from you from all directions.
Right.
And the basic nature of Infinite gameplay is very chaotic. Like, you're constantly being fired from some or the other direction, and that keeps you busy. Even in the final boss fight on the airship,
would you even consider it a boss fight, though?
It was not a boss fight. It was something like a final sequence, I would say.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, because there was no specific boss. There were, in fact, waves of enemies, and it was more like a tower defense, I felt like.
Yeah.
What a bitch of a one it was.
Yeah, you found it difficult, right?
Yeah, I kind of did. Wasn't so much... I knew what to do. I didn't notice right away. I knew I was supposed to protect the ship. I didn't know necessarily I was supposed to protect one specific thing on the ship, and I didn't know until later what it was. And then my other thing was I wasn't sure exactly what tactic to use to do my best on it. I did read an FAQ to help me out with it, and the one thing is they mentioned I don't really care for the RPG. It's too slow. So I go with the Gatling gun or whatever the hell it was called.
Crank gun.
And I actually ended up not finding that good. So I used the same powers he did. I used the one that pulls him in.
Oh, the water, was it? It was like, it was some water related, I think.
Tentacles.
Yes, like whatever, tentacle rape,
yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
And then the other one the guy mentioned to use was the possession. That was always the biggest problem because it took up the most of my resources. But and I actually used machine gun, and then I did use the RPG because I ended up using that. It was way easier to kill off the Patriots that way. So
can't remember what I used during that final sequence, but all I know is that I died to the point where I think I was down to like less than $25 on normal, because that's how much the game penalizes you is $25 when you die. Because that's something I noticed. I think I read it somewhere, like the strategy guide that I picked up when I got the game on its like midnight release. Is like on easy, it's something cheap. Normal, it's 25. Hard, it's 100. And then on 1999 mode, it's 200. But going
that
back
is
to
a shit. That 99, that is a really difficult mode. That mode is absolutely brutal. I tried playing it and I couldn't get past the first area.
Wow, that's something I've been tempted to actually give it a shot whenever
because
I get through my
whatever upgrade you make. Whatever upgrade you make, it's basically permanent. So you cannot revert back any kind of upgrade that you make. Mm-hmm. And so you're basically supposed to decide from the beginning what you want to focus on, what strengths you want to focus on.
Right.
So you cannot be jack of all trades. And that is basically something which I find it really difficult, because there are all these different sections where you are encouraged to use different weapons. Like, even if I do not favor using sniper rifles, there were sections with massive structures and skylines where you were encouraged to use sniper rifles. So if that doesn't happen in the 999 mode, then it's mm-hmm. going to be very difficult. And that is a difficult mode because it has this permadeath thing. If you fall below a certain level, I do not know, I guess it's 200 like you said,
uh-huh.
and if you die, then you are dead forever.
Gotcha.
That sounds like the game's no longer fun at that point.
Yeah, and the thing is, it also saves very frequently on that mode, so you cannot cheat and constantly restart your console. Although, why would you want to do that?
I don't even want to do that. No, I'm kidding. I actually ended up, when I was initially playing through the opening, I was thinking about how a speedrunner would take like 45 seconds to a minute, maybe, probably get through all that stuff instead of 55 minutes. But it turns out that isn't even the case, because they used glitches in the game to totally skip the chunks of it to the point where you didn't even go and have to throw the baseball. So,
a shame.
I wouldn't. I know. What a shame. They were looking to get that meaning out of it when they were speedrunning.
I can understand speedrunning for specific games, but for story-centric games, when you speedrun, it's basically just sucking out all the meaning out of it, because what's the point of playing Infinite if you're not playing it for the story or for the world?
I'm sure they did initially play it for those reasons.
Yeah.
But after a while, you know, you've seen the story, you don't need to see it again. So I get that. I don't see a problem with it. I mean, like, I do like it though when some games, like, I understand why most games don't, and I don't see the point of it anyway, but I actually was kind of surprised and liked it. Like, for instance, like when some games like Mirror's Edge took into account speedrunning and actually had that in there. Not just for the levels that you play in single player, but they also had additional levels you could do this stuff with. So it was quite fun. But anyways,
was anyone surprised by the reception which BioShock Infinite got? Because, okay, we know that since it's a BioShock game, it's going to be received highly by everyone, but I was kind of surprised by how unanimous the entire reception was in general. I mean,
I was shocked by BioShock. I know, I'm sorry. I apologize for that. No, I don't. I was surprised by my reaction more than anything. Because not being interested in the first two games, and we don't have, I knew of this game, obviously. You can't not know of it.
Yeah.
But I decided that's another BioShock game. I'm not going to care. So whatever, you know. I wasn't like, oh God, don't show me that game. But I was just gonna ignore it. I was just basically, when it comes up, I'm like, yeah, that's nice, whatever. And so it comes out, and I hear about it, and I hear the tone and the story and what it's about, basically about, you know, the big tones of racism in it and how that directs the story. And I was just like, and you know that, and you know the religious aspect of those two mixed, you know, obviously, and that's a thing that pretty much all nations at one point or another go through, it even in real life. And I'm just like, that's entertaining to me. That's the type of stuff I would like to see, I would like to experience. And so immediately I was like, it comes out, and I'm like, up to it's coming out, I'm just like, whatever, BioShock. And then it comes out, and I hear all the stuff, and I hear what it is, and I watch reviews, and I listen to reviews, and I hear people talk about it on podcasts, and I hear and I read other stuff, and I was just like, okay, I want this game. Like, I went from fuck, I don't give a shit, to, you know, it's BioShock, to where the fuck is it? Why isn't it in my house yet? Like a complete 180. Yeah. And I'm glad I bought it. I'm glad I paid $60. I don't regret it. And I don't buy many $60 games, so that means something.
Yeah, it's one of the few $60 games I'm actually happy to have in my possession, because it's a thoroughly enjoyable game. It just no matter how much that, like, people praise it for, it's like it takes you completely by surprise, you know, in its own way, or however you perceive it. And it's just like I always believe that, like, one person's experience differs from somebody else's. In BioShock, like how people go about BioShock Infinite, it's definitely a game that's like what we're doing. It's worth discussing, just to like kind of nitpick like some of the possible outcomes that we you know, later on this in the show that we kind of what we think about what could have happened, what might have happened. And it's just like, just like the title, Infinite, BioShock Infinite, it's just infinite possibilities.
That's the greatest reading into a title ever. I don't know what to tell you. Anyways, Eddie, did you play any of the previous games before now?
I have actually played the first one. Okay. I've played the first one, and, you know, okay, yeah, I understand it's probably gotten a lot of reception than it should have, but in all honesty, I actually enjoyed it. It was just a completely different
experience.
Like,
Ashton, did you? You obviously played them. I'm not shocked. But here's the thing with me is that I hadn't. Mm-hmm. Obviously, this is the first one I'd played. And because I was familiar enough with just what I heard about with the first game, I was still like, hey, callback, cool, at the end of the game.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and so it still kind of meant something to me, which is kind of weird seeing that.
That integration of the entire series canon, even though it seemed very distinct, all BioShock games take place in their own universe, what Infinite does is this almost impossible task of merging all of them. And there are so many parallels to be drawn between them. We'll talk about that later. But yeah, when I played the first BioShock, I think a lot of my opinion was influenced by my expectations, because I expected a lot from BioShock, because I had loved System Shock 2, which was...
You see, that's it. Like, I wasn't aware of that particular game until I got my hands on BioShock. See, for me, you know, when it comes to games, I'm always late to the party. And that was the case with BioShock. So I didn't know what to expect. I had played bits and pieces on like a friend's 360, until I got myself like a combo pack with Elder Scrolls 4 Oblivion and BioShock. So
what a pair!
Really, I'm probably one of the few that actually enjoyed BioShock thoroughly, because it was kind of like. It was like experiencing Half-Life, but in a different setting and a
Yes,
different
very
and a
true.
different mindset.
Very true. I think one of the main reasons why, like you earlier said, why did BioShock get received so well? It was because it had so many similarities with Half-Life 2. It was completely a narrative-driven experience of a first-person shooter. It was atmospheric, and also it had a gameplay which drew a lot from RPGs. So people liked it, critics liked it, and I think one of the aspects of the first BioShock which I do not understand was the twist at the end, which I frankly did not find that as impactful, because I somehow found the twist to be a major disappointment. Because this is for Matt, because he has not played the first game. Basically,
go ahead and tell me.
Is it the whole a man chooses a slave obeys? Is it that scene?
No. It's not about the little sisters, and not about them.
Okay.
It's about Atlas. Like, you are you follow a guy. You help out a guy and fight against an evil guy, and in the end, it turns out that he is the actual villain. So that twist is pretty lame, and people praised it. I do not know why.
But then they did it again with this one, right? That's the new one.
But the twist in this is actually very different, because
what
matters is what matters at the end of the day is not what the actual twist is, but how the twist is actually told.
It's presented.
Yeah, exactly. And how the story leads up to the twists and how it actually forebodes. Because actually, I do not know how many of you, if either of you have replayed it, but on the first thing when I finished BioShock Infinite was that I need to replay this. That was the sole
because just so I can catch up with what I missed out on to get a refresher, and just to see the little things that I missed out on, like, for example, the voxophones. There were a few voxophones that I'd missed my first time, so I'm kind of going back following the strategy guide that I have just to see what, you know, which areas I missed, you know, I didn't look at, so that I can kind of get all the little, you know, the nitpicky stuff, like with the telescopes, the voxophones, and the infusions.
Yeah.
So.
Hey, even the voxophones mainly tell about the world, and but even related to the story, there are so many minor details which I knew I had missed on my first playthrough, and I knew they would add up to the actual eventual story's ending once I had replayed it. So playing the game again was worth it, because I discovered so many small things which forebode the twist which happens at a later stage. And that is a really cool thing, because you can convey a sense of that something is going to happen, something is building up, like this weird feeling inside your gut, but never to the point that the twist becomes predictable. And that is a really great example of quality storytelling, which Ken Levine and his team does.
Smother. So, I was like, wait a minute.
Can we talk about the twist and the ending now?
Yeah, if you want, go ahead.
Yeah. So, go on.
Well, I was going to say, going back to when you brought up about the huge atmosphere that BioShock Infinite had to offer. For me, going through my first playthrough, I was kind of missing that claustrophobic atmosphere that the first BioShock offered. But I had to remind myself, I was like, okay, that was a game on itself. This is something different.
Yes.
And Infinite is something different, and you just have to get used to. But it, you know, it makes sense, because you have all the entire city is your playground. It's I've told this to a few people. It's like a giant amusement park for grown-ups, because you're going about the city killing people that are out to get you, and it's just like the way that the place is so vibrant, catching that early 1900s look of it. It's like I'm like in Disney World. This is crazy. I'm like in like a Disney World-esque,
which is
like,
so fitting
setting.
Because Walt Disney himself is a racist. Anyway, and he can't draw despite the fact that people think he can, because they always showed him that way.
Yeah,
it was doctored. But the thing was, now it's escaping my mind. Oh,
boy.
I know, big deal.
Yeah, like you were saying, comparing Rapture and Columbia, I can agree on that Rapture had the better atmosphere, but it was partly because of the fact that Rapture was more forthcoming in its apparent atmosphere, whereas in Columbia, everything is not pretty clear at the start. Like, it builds this vision of a perfect city, and you are made to believe that it's a perfect city because everything is so perfect, whereas in Rapture, it was a perfect city, but now it's not, because obviously something went wrong. Whereas in Colombia, something is wrong about it, but you're not quite able to pinpoint exactly what it is. It's obviously the racist, and there's an uprising, but there's also something weird about it, which constantly permeates. And I think rather than hit you in the face like Rapture did when you first entered it from through the elevator.
The lighthouse.
I gotta say real quick, I don't know about you, but when I was paying attention to what the people were saying and stuff, I wasn't sold on the "it's perfect." That's some wacko's version of perfect, let me tell you.
The thing was that people believed in that. People believed in that so-called religion of America. And
Well, I get what you're getting at, but I'm just saying.
Yeah.
I didn't buy it.
it's just the whole like mindset, because it was, it's still like 12 years after the turn of a century, so it's like things, even though it's like 12 years from 1900, things are fairly new as people are discovering. Now I've kind of lost my train of thought there. even though, what I want to say on that is that, like, there's still things that people are discovering for themselves. So okay, moving on.
Let's move on. One thing that I noticed, what I thought was hilarious, especially the ending, was that they, when they're doing that callback to the first game, what's her name? The girl that's with you?
Elizabeth,
that's right. Elizabeth, I like how she's like, it's like, I'll see you underwater, how ridiculous. And I'm like, yeah, that's so ridiculous, you know, because, you know, a city in the sky is any less ridiculous. I thought that was hilarious.
It was kind of a nice. Go ahead.
I don't know if you have read the theories which pertain to that specific thing, where you revisit Rapture late in the game, and right up to the ending, there are many hints being dropped, like. That basically the Booker DeVitt, Comstock,
Booker,
and the original guy Jack and Andrew Ryan. They are basically the same people, because both are clones of each other, like. Comstock and Booker are the same guy.
Yeah.
Right? And Andrew Ryan and Jack are the same guy. Like, they're cloned, at least. They're clones of one another.
I didn't. I guess that kind of makes sense.
Yes.
So I always thought Jack from the first game was like a was kind of like, I don't know. I never thought of him to be a clone, but that is, I guess that kind of makes sense.
No,
now.
He's not an exact clone, but he is. He has genes of Andrew Ryan implemented into his body,
okay.
Which is why he's able to operate all the machinery in Rapture, right?
Gotcha.
And that was yes, and that was explicitly explained in the first game. And what I found surprising in that theory was that the theory said that when Booker goes down into Rapture, he's able to operate the machinery of Rapture, which means that he basically shares the same genes as its parallel universe creator, Andrew Ryan, or Jack. So it basically ties them both into a common thing. And then they also showed the concept arts of the Little Sisters and Elizabeth side by side, and Songbird and Big Daddy side by side. So it was just like a massive mind fuck. And I saw this right after the ending, and I was like, "Oh, holy crap! I'm not gonna sleep tonight."
just finding out that Booker DeWitt is Zachary Comstock, I was like, "Huh? What?" And I was just like, "Okay, hold on, stop right there. Let me try to process this real quick. What?" But it kind of makes sense because towards the end it shows him, you know, it shows two outcomes. One is where he gets baptized, and then the other is where he like refused the baptism. Yeah. So it's like, it makes sense, but it's like you're still get second guessing yourself, like, okay, how is this possible? It makes sense, but how?
It wasn't completely out of the blue. Like, there were a few moments when you could have, because this is basically a very old trick, like the hero and the villain are the same guy, but you couldn't see how it was possible. And I think the manner in which the ending was done, like right after the final sequence on the airship, just simply warping players into Rapture was like a splash of cold water on your face. Like, it was a shock to people, because it just came out of the blue. Nobody expected that to ever happen. And then the next 10-15 minutes are packed with so many twists. And then the final scene, which I felt was really well done, like, it ended at a perfect moment. It was not stretched or added up.
Yeah.
And the manner in which the pre-Elizabeth / Anna DeVitt drown you, and they're seeing their haunting, the reflection of their faces, it's really haunting.
Yeah, and then just to see them disappear one by one, it's like okay, so pretty much the guy that you were playing as was kind of like the origin of all these other Elizabeths. So the only way to end this, to end the cycle, which, you know, kind of refers to the song that you hear at the beginning of the game, you know, will the circle be unbroken?
Unbroken.
Will the be unbroken? So.
Symbolism.
Exactly.
Yeah. And it ends at a perfect moment where you do not know whether the main or the Elizabeth, which we know of, survives or not. Like, does she disappear or does she not? The screen blacks out.
That's right.
At the moment that she's supposed to.
So
I would almost argue since none of that stuff happened, so that no, she wouldn't. That version of her wouldn't survive.
I agree.
I think it'd be something completely different that the player did not experience. So.
Exactly.
I know. Because I would say, like, going through, like, the various lighthouses, because it goes back to the whole discussion of different doors, other possibilities.
Yeah.
So, I can see why Matt would say, that the, like, when Elizabeth was just like there, just standing there, she probably wouldn't have survived. Like,
explain
even
to me, Ansh, explain to me the brother sister duo that shows up every so often, because I thought they were going to be.
Or are they brother? Or are they?
They're the same
sister?
Person. They're the same person.
They're the same person.
They are the same person. Yes.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
they are. One is born in, like, if you looked at the flashbacks, you would see that there is the brother is in Booker's dimension, whereas the sister is in Comstock's dimension. So they basically have mastered this art of, or
wow, okay,
you can call it the science of traveling between tears. And they are basically, because I think they are the most interesting set of characters, because they are basically kind of like the game designers who are talking to you at so many points. Like, yeah, exactly. And I think that coin flip thing is a really interesting thing. Have you looked into the alternate videos of that? Coin flips? That decision where you,
I don't think so.
Early on, where you either say heads or tails.
No.
And yeah, like, they ask you to say heads or tails, and for a moment you expect two choices to appear, and they don't. Like, in the cutscene itself, Booker says heads, and it turns out to be anything. It could be heads or it could be tails. But what it says is that no matter what he says, because it turns out that I looked at the video of another guy, and in that video, Booker said tails. So that thing is basically random. What he calls out is random. So whatever decision he makes, it doesn't matter, because it's always, the outcome is always going to be heads, which is what he strikes on the chalkboard.
Mind
blown. The
exactly.
Lucid twins are the same people, and they pretty much were needed for everything to happen, because if they were not there, then Comstock would never have been able to infiltrate the dimension of Booker and not able to steal Anna.
Yeah. So, like, going back to that, like, which is what I was gonna try to talk about, is how did you guys perceive when you find out that Anna DeWitt is Elizabeth, because of, like, the whole, like, missing part of her pinky.
That was a really well done scene, though. Pretty emotional.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess maybe I'm just cold hearted. But I didn't really. I mean, I was like, I see that. I see now. But I didn't really think much else about it.
Right.
Because they kind of were going back and forth all the time. Like, she's this person's daughter and that person's daughter, and it's not his daughter and it is his daughter. I didn't know. At some point, I was just like, that doesn't really interest me. I don't know. But. Yeah, I was still like, oh, okay, I see. And then it would be, because you are Zachary's daughter, because you are everyone's daughter, because fuck it all, they're all the same. Everybody's one and the same.
Yeah. It was well done. It wasn't, like, I guess it was something that you could have expected, but at the same time, you weren't so sure. At least that was the impression I got. I mean, I was still a tad shocked, but not as shocked as like finding out that, you know, Booker and Comstock were one and the same.
Yeah. So I wasn't really surprised by the reveal of Anna and Elizabeth being the same person, because I could perceive that thing happening at some point, because when the player and the female AI who's been partnering you throughout do not have any kind of romantic connection which is highly unusual for games, surprisingly.
Right.
Yeah. So I thought that, yeah, maybe this person could turn out to be someone related to Booker in some way. Or maybe not. I was not, like, sure about it. But, yeah, I wasn't surprised by it because Booker did have a lot of emotional issues attached to whoever this Anna was. And we all perceived perhaps Anna was his wife, dead or alive, but
mm-hmm.
yeah, it turns out it was his daughter. And the interesting thing about that was that the flashbacks were done really well, and the post-credit sequence, it really, again, was like a Schrodinger's bell, Schrodinger's cat, or rather.
All right.
Yeah, I'm not sure if you've heard of it, but that's
no.
pretty much like, yeah. That is basically
yeah.
That's like a scientific thing about. It's pretty much related to what Schrodinger and Einstein were doing back then, about the theory of parallel dimensions, and it's basically like Anna. There are the. You can hear the wind chimes in Anna's room, and whether she exists or not hangs on absolutely nothing, because you have basically killed yourself, and what you see post-credits exists in an entirely different dimension. The dimension
is completely
different from when from what you have been playing in this entire game. Because think of what you have been playing as, like, the moment the camera blacks out at the end, that's basically the end of your dimension. That dimension ceases to exist anymore. And yes, so that entire post-credit sequence takes place in a different dimension, and you wonder whether anything you did before in that old dimension affected what you are doing now. So it was an interesting situation, and I think it left things really interesting. It was pretty much like Inception's End, if you remember that.
Oh, right, of course. Like, whether if he was awake or if he was still asleep.
Yes, the top would fall or the top would keep spinning. So, yeah, uh-huh. I think that brings me to a point of criticism, which many people would say. People were disappointed that BioShock's story did not turn out to be a BioShock story, but rather a Christopher Nolan-inspired story.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
Someone needs to stop. Someone's thinking too much about it.
Yeah, someone's really reading into it. You know, I personally, the post-credits ending, I actually liked, because it just, the way that it ends is like, I absolutely loved it, because it leaves it open for discussion. If
yes.
If what you saw was the possibility of, because I've seen, like, I even watched videos just to, like, refresh myself before the podcast. Like, there's been talk of, like possibly that, like, the dimension that you saw as the game ended was, like, that dimension which Booker and Anna didn't go to Columbia.
Yeah.
So it leaves open for discussion as to what happens next. I kind of thought of it as like, huh, so it kind of comes in full circle to some extent. That's kind of how I perceived it. Full circle in which, well, eventually it just kind of like, it kind of repeats itself. But that's kind of how I saw it. Like, okay, so it just kind of went a reset button, and you're just kind of back to square one in some way.
Mm.
But oh well.
Right you are, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, but like you were saying, who would possibly not like BioShock's story? Apparently, there are quite a lot of number of people who were not pleased with it. I can perhaps understand their reasons for it, but I do not agree with them, because I personally enjoyed the story and I loved it. But they basically said that the story did not have, or rather the narrative did not have a coherent feature, or it wasn't coherent enough. Like, it started with something. It started with the focus on Colombia, with focus on the America as religion, with the focus on racism. And it eventually, halfway down the line, it becomes this personal tale between these three people, out of which two people happen to be the same person.
I don't know how they're not surprised by that, or why they're surprised by that, because the whole point of him clearing his debt was kind of the central point anyway, and it was personal to begin with. So as far as I'm concerned, it didn't focus on anything other than that the whole time. So
yeah, but the personal objective, I guess, they thought would be was a driving force, but rather not the main focus of the story, because the game invests so much time on Vox Populi and everyone else, on the founding fathers, and then suddenly, like, kind of loses interest in them. And I guess that's okay, and I don't really blame, like, these people probably expected a thematic, politically heavy story with themes of racism and things like that, and it turned out to be a typical Chris Nolan kind of story. So they have their reasons to be disappointed by it, but I couldn't see why, because there were themes which complemented how the story turned out. Like, I especially liked how Vox Populi, who are initially painted to be these oppressed group of people who are rebelling against the snotty and snobby founding fathers, and then suddenly you switch into an alternate universe where they are the ones who are ruling everything, and you find that power corrupts them all. Even they do not turn out to be as loving or as benevolent.
Regardless of any outcome, everybody's going to have their heroes and villains.
Yes.
Yeah, and it was like going into Fink Town, resembling in some way of, if anybody's ever seen the silent film classic Metropolis, just seeing the people wake up and then getting ready to work, and going through a rhythm of, especially when you hear like a metronome playing with like coinciding with the music, and just seeing the people kind of wiping left to right, I was like, that's Metropolis. Yes. That is like they really got that from Metropolis, and it was a nice touch. It really was.
It was more like a clear reference to that movie.
It really was.
When you first enter Finktown.
Finktown,
rather.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go to work and get paid in our credits, and then you can only shop at our stores, and so they make sure that their money is always with them.
Exactly.
So. Yeah, it was, I guess I'm kind of disgusted out, I guess you could say, about this game. I mean,
what did you guys think about the ghost fight? I thought that was a horrible sequence. I didn't enjoy it.
Throughout the game, I give props to them for not, you know, for going out of their way by not throwing in a boss battle up until that ghost. It's like, okay, I think it was them just being like, okay, guys, We gotta try to make this a quote unquote video game. So I guess the ghost sequence was like their way of having a boss battle.
The entire ghost, the entire part of the game which involves the ghost was completely unnecessary, because it didn't.
Yeah, exactly. I didn't. I just like, okay, how does this fit in with the story?
The ghost was basically just an excuse to give convenient flashbacks, because that was basically what you were doing. You were going from one unrelated place to another just because you could open that device and look back through the tear and look at a flashback sequence. That's basically what the game tried to do, and that was pretty lame, because that was not what the game generally was capable of. And I think the game sunk to probably its lowest point during that time. It could have done without it, because it seemed to me like unnecessary padding.
That's probably the one battle or series of battles that it was over before the final battle with the ghost happened, and that's finally when I understood how to fight her. And
Yeah.
then I was like, okay, well now I don't. Now I know how to fight you now, and now we're done. So that was little bit
Yeah,
annoying.
it's like I forget how many times I died just to like, okay, how do I even do this? So I quit the game because I had kind of like that had just depleted my money. I think I'd beaten her the first time. I beaten her like the first time.
I was a
And
tank, man. I didn't
then I
have
yeah, and then
any.
I
I didn't have to worry about money.
yeah, and then I well, and then I quit the game. I was like, okay, I lost plenty of money, and I think I had something else to do at that
What did
time.
you when you put your stuff towards, to upgrade health or shields or whatever, what did you usually put it towards?
I tend to like kind of even it out.
Yeah, I think that's the problem. Because I usually went for shields. Because I'm like, what's the point of there's no it doesn't matter what my health is if the shields are awesome. So that's what I thought. So I didn't really care about my health as much.
Yeah, that's what happens when you don't play a lot of RPGs. You make poor
Yeah,
decisions.
I
That's the lesson of the day, folks. Play RPGs, make better decisions, live a better life.
was like, you know what? Because I remember years ago playing games, and in fact, actually, I probably learned that lesson of not spreading yourself thin like you kind of did, Eddie. When I played Borderlands, because I was more or less doing that, and so I was like, well, I want to be specialized in something that kicks ass and not be mediocre or anything. So that's why I respect my character in there. My soldier to be more specific to one side, and at least more or less specific to how I wanted to play him. And here I was just like, health is kind of stupid. You're like, I kind of felt, especially early on. I mean, later, yeah, you want some more health, but I felt that early on the enemies are gonna be easy, so you're kind of you go for health right away. You upgrade that sooner. Then rather than later, you're kind of throwing that upgrade away, I felt. So, especially, really any of them, but if you go for shields like the first couple times, it's a much better choice.
I see. Maybe it's something to consider, especially when in 1999 mode, if and when I get that chance.
That's a brutal mode. I don't know if y'all been reading the post-release criticism of this game, but it has led to some really interesting discussions. One of the terms which comes around, if you read them, it's ludonarrative dissonance. And let me explain that. That is basically the game saying something and then contradicting it in some other way. Now, I can give an example. There are a couple of examples right now about games like that. There's Tomb Raider, where Lara Croft, who makes an emotional first kill at 1 hour into the game, and then suddenly starts shooting people just like she was born and trained and raised up on guns.
Right.
And then there's Uncharted Nathan Drake, who is considered to be your general good guy, average good guy, and still he kills thousands of people. So that is basically gameplay contradicting what the story states.
I wasn't as far as on
That never really occurred to me.
I didn't really notice that, and I can see what you're saying though, but I didn't really notice it or bother me in Uncharted, but I haven't played the new Tomb Raider, and
Yeah.
even I noticed that just by what I'd
That
seen
was a
at
pretty
this
big
point.
thing for Tomb Raider. I
Yeah,
don't think it.
because she was all like, she's like, oh, it's so hard, and oh, everything's horrible, and it's a trial by fire and that type of shit, and then all of a sudden she's like, boop, 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 and knock them all off. I'm like,
It was the same
what the
case for
fuck, are
Far
you
Cry
new to
3 as
this or
well.
not?
Yeah, exactly. It was the same case for Far Cry 3 as well. That guy makes Jason, he makes an emotional first kill, and then suddenly he becomes a trained hunter
Yeah, he
who
just
starts
oh.
snuck up on
Becomes
people.
Rambo. Wow.
Yeah. So Yeah, so Jim Sterling had a really good argument about how games need, with storylines which are as good as BioShock Infinite is, they need to look beyond traditional genres if they want to really need to have a good impact of their story. Like, and I agree with him in a sense. Like, I think BioShock Infinite would have been a lot better in terms of a story if it was an adventure game, a first-person adventure with pure exploration, interaction, and that's it. Mm-hmm. I think shooting was mostly in BioShock Infinite was completely unnecessary. Like, there were enemies just because this was a shooter.
Oh, so just to be a video game for the sake of actually being considered
exactly
a video game, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, and this brings me back to that ghost sequence. Like, they had to channel you and push you through three different points where you could look through the tear and see all the flashback sequences, mm-hmm. and they had to pepper all those areas with enemies because that's what you need to do to keep players rooted and interested. And I think it's he makes a valid point because designers are not able to see beyond that point of they feel like players need to be constantly engaged, they constantly need to be doing something active, right? But when that's not really the case, like in Infinite, we were not doing any kind of shooting in the first 55 minutes, but still we were engaged in the game and we were immersed in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So I think BioShock Infinite would have been a better game if it was an adventure game, but in its current state, it is also a great game. That's all.
Absolutely.
I had to say about it.
Right. Kind of like, I don't know, this may be far-fetched, but kind of like Metroid Prime, it had like your shooter elements, but I wouldn't say it's a first person shooter. It's like what Ansh is going about with BioShock Infinite as being a first person adventure. That's kind of how I gathered from with Metroid Prime. I mean, yes, it's first person. Yes, you're shooting, but there are certain elements in that game in which are open for exploring and gathering other goodies and whatnot.
Well, that's a Metroid game, so
true.
Yeah.
That shouldn't shock anybody.
Yeah, but Metroid Prime was marketed as a first-person shooter, so again, people came into it with different expectations. They expected like this was Nintendo's answer to Halo or things like that.
People did that.
Yeah, I know a couple of people who did expect that because
wow, that's
I don't know why. I don't know why, but I think
that I'm not saying that wouldn't be awesome, you know, for them to try that.
Yeah,
but you know, I don't want why anyone would immediately assume that that'd be the case.
They wear helmets.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
They wear helmets. We have been schooled. All right.
I actually like all these kind of discussions which are happening about the state of shooters because shooters have become so
boring,
repetitive and boring. Yeah.
The same old thing all the time. Well, they are anymore.
Like,
back in the day, it was a bunch of, even though they, you know, the term Doom clone was used.
Yeah.
They were still, a lot of them were completely different as far as setting and. For the most part, it was they still different. Like I always liked the callback to Strife. Probably no one remembers that game.
No, I couldn't say.
But it was it had elements outside of the first person shooters that you wouldn't expect at the time. You know, it had actual RPG elements and stories and choices to make. And
when was this?
This was like 96.
All right.
I seriously think you should try it. At least
System
look
Shock
up video.
System Shock had, I think it was the first game to have RPG elements in a shooter, but I think that was 94.
Yeah, well, I didn't play that.
Which platformer is this?
Huh?
Which platform was this on?
It was on the
this
PC.
Game you're talking about. Oh, cool, I can try it.
Yeah, you're like, I tried. It's not on any current downloadable services, unfortunately.
Okay.
But at least, but the very least, you can look up video for it.
What's the name for it?
Strife.
Okay. I think I heard about it.
Done by Velocity, if I remember correctly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's you go and you try to find this piece together, this weapon called the Sigil. That's it. It was it. Despite what might have come before, they did it first. That was the first game that I saw those elements together in, and so mm-hmm. it stayed with me because of that. It has pretty interesting writing. Regardless of whether you think it's corny or not, that's to be seen. I always felt that the warden was kind of a snarky fucking bastard, and but it's voice yeah. acted, so that's great. That's something that wasn't common back then, as often having right. all the characters voiced, and they were. So yeah, I think it's pretty good. You do revisit areas, and yeah, definitely at least look it up and give it a shot if you ever can.
Yeah, sure, will do. Yeah, but like. Despite shooters having the same old thing, I'm glad that all these things are being talked about because of the fact that have been a few games recently, like obviously BioShock Infinite, and before that there was Spec Ops, and these games have been creating so much good discussion about how games communicate with players and play around with their minds, and that is a really good thing because there is a lot more which can be done with the first person shooter, which is not being done by the developers because they are trapped in this narrow mindset that everything needs to be this specific way, everything needs to have...
particularly with how the whole first person shooter market is saturated yes. with one Call of Duty after another.
So many... Just the general, and we've talked about this in the podcast in the past.
Yeah.
That the general business mindset, at least in the States, mm-hmm. is money do me right now. I don't care about the future. I don't care about laying the foundation yeah. for anything new. Just give me money now. So that's why everybody looks at Call of Duty and goes, "There's the Call of Duty money. I'm gonna chase the Call of Duty money." And I think I'm gonna and they fancy this. I guess you could call an alternate dimension through a tear. That where they get the money, but that's not the reality we live in. We don't live in that dimension. They're not getting that money. It's just not going to happen. So instead of something that would be beneficial for them down the line, where they might make a lot of money, they just decide, well, we're going to chase the Call of Duty money that they're never going to get. And that's the biggest problem I think with the industry right now.
Yeah, I agree on that. Like, the franchise longevity is totally irrelevant in the publisher and company's minds right now. Like, they just want to milk every single franchise which is selling for them, and they don't care if they milk it to the point where it basically kills the franchise, and then at some point they may have to even kill it or put it to rest, like what Harmonix did to Guitar Hero.
I was gonna say that if you didn't.
Rock band,
honestly, at first we were all like, Guitar Hero's awesome, and then they start, and then when it sell it off, it's get, just milk it, and then when it died, instead of going, oh, too bad, we're like, thank God, you know, and we shouldn't be saying that, but that's what they made us say, and I really feel that's why, and just to bring it up again, because I guess it's kind of worth it, but Strife was an anomaly type of shooter at the time. When it came out in 96, it wouldn't even come out today if it hadn't back then, I don't think. Just knowing what it is, I don't think it would. People would. I mean, maybe I'm wrong because there is a lot of.
Spec Ops does show that there is a considerable market for people who are highly disillusioned by, and we know a lot of people who are disillusioned by the shooters. So there are a lot of people who want something different from their shooters. And the funny thing about Spec Ops was that it was marketed in such a way like this is a generic military shooter, and there are all the same tropes, three guys, basic.
Two weapons. Lemon. You say that, and it's like, I remember back when, you know, Call of Duty 4, and it's like, oh God, it's amazing, it changed the shooters, and it did. But now it's like,
not for the better.
We're saying that now for those people like us that want something different, we're looking at Call of Duty the same way we looked at Guitar Hero a couple years ago and going, when are they gonna kill it? Because we don't want to see this shit anymore.
Yeah.
Because even now, it's like, okay, it would be nice to actually see a World War II shooter again.
Yeah, imagine we say that, right?
But yeah.
Here's another thing. Back when all the Doom clones were coming out, I don't remember ever saying, oh God, kill the Doom clones. Because they were different enough, it didn't feel like the same thing.
Yeah.
It was like there was that Blake Stone, Aliens of Gold, and I played that demo, and just, you know, people were actually trying to be creative, whereas now it's just like, we must be Call of Duty, which is why you got that Medal of Honor being Call of Duty, and there's a problem, it doesn't sell.
I think on top of being creative back then, even if they were not creative back in the 90s, the main reason why we get tired of shooters so easily now is because of the constant marketing of a generic shooter. The marketing wasn't really that much of a big case back in the 90s. Like, it was a luxury for many companies. But now it's almost become a mainstay, and it's become a necessity for your... So now we constantly get flooded with ads and whatnot, contests about new Call of Duty game, the new Medal of Honor game, and whatnot. So that's why we get tired. Like, this is a lot of bullshit about shooters, which I don't care about. So I'm getting irritated about this and just kill it all.
Yeah, and before I was a couple, like, I remember saying this in past podcasts. You know, it's like, you know, I think this industry would do well to have a crash, and I welcome it. Now I've changed it.
I think I remember.
Yes, but now I've changed it. I've upped the ante. Now it just needs to fucking die.
Yes, it needs to die.
I need the whole.
Yeah.
I really feel that just a crash will not help anymore. It, especially after, you know, and my main thinking of this changed after Microsoft revealed their screw the consumer Xbox, and I just look at it and go, yeah, we kind of, they're not going to learn with the crash. We need to kill it all. So it's sad.
Yeah, we'll get on topic with Microsoft in a moment, but yeah,
well,
I'm actually,
we're going quite long here, and I actually kind of want to wrap it up anyway. So okay. I will get on. Well, you know, I don't have a schedule. We can do this fucking some other time, like next week or something, but I just, you know, whenever I feel like doing, I guess, but I just, you know,
feel like
we just need to get, stuff.
Yeah, but I agree with you that the games industry needs a crash because, and it's pretty much going to get a crash soon because the current model of the AAA game development is not sustainable because and as we have seen in cases of Tomb Raider, where the games are built on such a high budget that even 3.2 million sales or 4 million sales is not able to recover the expenses in a sufficient manner to be called successful. I mean, that is the biggest shame because it's like Square is just signing off all the funds and everybody is using them for their own amount and nobody's keeping a track of it. And when the quarterly reports come out, the financial reports come out, they suddenly panic and then they start shutting down studios and laying people off. So, like, if you have been following the news, EA has shut down almost 10 studios in the last 3-4 months. And that's a massive number of studios to be shut down for any company, even if it happens to be the biggest company in AAA games.
Yeah. All right, well, we'll end this podcast here. I thank you guys for coming on.
But yeah, if you guys haven't played BioShock Infinite, and if any of this has spoiled you, haha. But no, seriously,
who would be so dumb to watch it if they have not played BioShock Infinite? who'd be dumb to stay up till so long in the podcast, so late in the podcast?
Yeah, I don't know. That sounds pretty stupid. And if you are and you haven't played it, you're like me because I do that a lot, those things in the past, and because I just don't give a shit because it doesn't bother me. It's not so much that I know the ending; it's how you get to the ending. And I wish more people thought that way because I don't care that I know the ending. That's not important. But regardless, yeah, you either if you, there's no nobody's listening to this right now has been like, oh God, you were spoiling it. I didn't know. No, fuck that. They know full well, and they either aren't listening because they don't want it spoiled, or they didn't care like I don't. So.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, definitely worth looking at. To be honest, it's like as soon as I finished, I was like, okay, this is it. Game of the year right there. That's it for me.
Well, I think it's a little early for that, but
I know, but
there are a couple of contenders coming up for that, but
right,
yeah, it was definitely a game which you know that when the end of the year rolls down, you know this game is going to stay on your mind because
yeah, it's going to be the most memorable of this year, or one of the most memorable that you've
ever... one of the least,
Eddie's just so ready to call it game of the year.
Yeah, that was my initial reaction after I finished. Like, this is game of the year right here. It's like I don't care anymore. This is it.
Well, see, I also think that you give it time, you let it settle in. Maybe you'll change your mind because, you know, you can't just.
I know.
You know, you're on the high notes at the end of the game. So, you know, it's easy to say that at the end.
But he's still saying it's going to be his game of the year. So I think he's had it.
It
he's
probably
had
will
time
be
to...
for him. I can see it. I know Eddie well enough.
Don't jinx it.
I know he'll do it. He'll do it. He'll at least run it up. That's for sure. It'll be runner up. Anyway.
I don't know if it'll be my game of the year. My game of the year is generally obscure strategy games.
Yeah. But yeah, I know, like there's The Last of Us, there's Grand Theft Auto 5.
Yay.
It sounds excited. Oh, wait, never mind. yeah, mine might be the Dungeons & Dragons beat 'em up. Oh, wait.
Oh, yeah.
Why would that be? No, but I am looking forward to that because...
Dragon's Crown?
No. Dungeons and Dragons, Capcom beat 'em ups are re-releasing.
That's right.
Because I like my beat 'em ups, so goddamn it, I gotta have my beat 'em ups. All right. Anyways, we're gonna get out of here before we take Dragon's on too much longer rambling for no reason, even though it's great to ramble for no reason. So, yes. Where can the listeners find you, Ansh?
Sitting in my chair.
Oh, you're funny. On the internet, you numbnut.
Okay, they can find me on Twitter, lightnarcissus.
And Eddie?
Oh, Twitter as well, and WordPress, and a few other sites, but really, just simply Google Sonic Homeboy. Wherever I've been, I'm easy to find.
That's good. And Heart Knight on Twitter. Without the E in heart and an extra K in night, just in case you spell it wrong like someone else did. I actually had someone try to say that they were me when someone on a live stream said, hey, who's Heart Knight? And so this guy said, I'm Heart Knight, and he spelled it with heart with an E and left off the K in night, so it was hilarious.
He was probably you from a different dimension.
Oh, yeah, the tear. Good one. Mm-hmm. Good one. I felt that nudge in my gut.
Never gets old.
No, it doesn't. So, yes, and of course, this is the Heart and Saga Podcast. Home on mjkurtzman.wordpress.com. So it's where you can find all the past episodes. And now, hey, before I forget, we're now on YouTube.
Whee!
Yeah, don't start that. Really, you don't say. Yes, we're on YouTube now. Episode 30, the previous one. I just threw it up there as the first one. I'm not going to put the previous ones to that one up, but there is a link on all the places that are awesome that that you can find the old ones, audio form at least, so... and this one, of course, will be up there, too, if you're listening to that there. Hello, YouTube. And goodbye, YouTube, and goodbye, everybody else. We're gone. See ya.